I'm Stephanie Neely. Some of you may remember me as the former treasurer of the city of Chicago. Well, now Allstate is in my good hands, and I am happy, happy, happy to be here. I always like to start off my little speeches with a quote from a famous philosopher. So I'm going to start off by quoting that very famous philosopher, Beyonce. Who runs the world? Who runs the world? That's right, girls run the world. And we are here today to celebrate women of power and the men who are in the room who want to support women of power and to get together. Jan, thank you so much for asking me and Josina to be co-hosts of this year's luncheon, one of the best lunches all year round. I have a big time letter from another powerful woman that I would like to read. At the very top, it says, Hillary for America. What it should say is Madam President for America. So if you'll indulge me and let me read this, I'd appreciate it. It says, Dear friends, I'm so delighted to send greetings to all those gathered in Chicago for Congresswoman Jan Schakowsky's 2015 Ultimate Women's Power Lunch. That's all of us. While I regret that I'm unable to be there with you, I do want to take this opportunity to thank Jan for her remarkable service and leadership in Congress. Throughout her career, she has been a stalwart advocate for women and families and a champion for our shared values. I'm running for president because I want to make sure that all people can fulfill their potential and not only get ahead, but stay ahead. I know I won't win this campaign alone, that I need to work as hard as I can to earn every vote, and that I need partners like Jan and all of you by my side. I am committed to building an inclusive nationwide effort at the grassroots level. That means organizing on the ground in all 50 states and right here in Chicago. The work begins now, and I am so thrilled to be on the campaign trail and to share in conversations with everyday Americans across our country. This event is music to my ears because we know that when women succeed, our country succeeds. So let's celebrate the many extraordinary women gathered here today and redouble our efforts to build a better future for every family, every small business, and every American. Onward. With best wishes, I am sincerely yours, Madam President Hillary Rodham Clinton.
Good afternoon. My name is Josina Morita. I'm on. Oh. I'm honored to be here today as your co-chair with Stephanie Neely and introduce Jan Schakowsky. Because, like many of you, I love Jan. I don't just little heart Taylor Swift heart Jan. I big heart Jan. I big heart Jan, not just because she's my congresswoman. Jan is a fighter for women, for immigrants, for people of color, for workers, and a fearless voice for fairness and justice in our true north here in Illinois and across the country. She's a true supporter of women, especially progressive women and women of color who want to get involved in politics. She has helped pave the way ahead of us. She's held the door open and provided real opportunities for us to grow and lead and to run. In 2014, I ran for Metropolitan Water Reclamation District, and Jan was there with me from the beginning, endorsed early, and was there through the end, the very end. 10 p.m. on election night, I lost. I'd said all my thank yous. I was ready to go home and die. But they said, Jan is coming. And she did. And she said three things to me that I will never forget. First, she said, the most eloquent and articulate thing that somebody can say to you in that moment, she said, It sucks. It really, really sucks. Second, she said the most important thing one can hear at that moment. She said, I've been there. I've lost my first race too. And third, she said the last thing that you really want to hear in that moment. She said, you will run again. And she said, I will be with you and you will win. And to me, that's Jan. She tells you what she thinks. She tells you not what you want to hear, but what you need to hear. And she tells you what to do. And she commits to being there to do it with you. And that's why I big heart Jan Schakowsky. Ladies and ladies, the fierce and the fabulous Jan Schakowsky.
Thank you. Thank you. I love you so much. You look marvelous. Thank you. Oh, thank you so much, Stephanie and Josina. Wonderful co-chairs and examples of the next generation of leaders who are making such a great difference in our country. And I'm so happy to see that so many, we have such diversity in age and so many different ways in this audience. So I really want to thank you, sisters and very secure men who are here today, as always. Right. So, yes. I think that was the man. Anyway, I want to, as always, introduce the people who are standing up and running for office, the people who are in office, and we're going to do it like we did last year. By the way, who's here for the first time? I want to see hands. Great. Okay. Wonderful. Welcome. I want to hear one good, loud clap. Because I want everyone to be recognized, stand up real quick, and then just one loud clap. So first of all, I want to introduce my colleagues. Bill Foster is here from the 4th Congressional District. One clap. All right, let's try it again. Bill Foster. There we go. Robin Kelly, Congresswoman. Brad Schneider, Congressman again pretty soon. Mike Frericks, Illinois Treasurer. Alexi Janulius, former Illinois Treasurer. Lisa Madigan, Illinois Attorney General. Former Governor Pat Quinn. Former Lieutenant Governor Sheila Simon. We have county elected officials. Cook County State's Attorney Anita Alvarez. Board of Review Commissioner Mike Carbonaggi. Cook County Commissioner Bridget Gaynor, President of the Cook County Board, Tony Preckwinkle, Metropolitan Water Reclamation District Commissioner Deb Shore, and Mariana Spiropoulos. I want to introduce my friend and former Illinois State Representative and Head of Women Family Services for the state, Julie Hamos. Former Ambassador Faye Hartog-Levin. Okay, now I have City of Chicago officials. Well, of course, you've heard from Stephanie. She was former Chicago Treasurer, Stephanie Neely. Marianne Smith, former Chicago Alderman. Township officials, Ann Flanagan-Bancy, Maureen Township Supervisor. Marilyn Glazer, Township Supervisor. McHenry Township Supervisor, Mary Mahady. Retired Evanston Township Assessor, Bonnie Wilson. Moraine Township Trustee, Cindy Wilson. Municipal officials, Evanston Alderman, Peter Braithwaite. Evanston Alderman, Jane Grover. Highland Park City Council, Alyssa Noble. Evanston Alderman, Brian Miller. Former Park Ridge Alderman, Rex Parker. District 111 School Board, Yumi Ross, Mayor of Highland Park, Nancy Rotering, and candidate for Congress. Municipal officials, President of Park Ridge Park District, Mary Wynne Ryan, Evanston Alderman, Mark Tendem, Evanston Mayor, Liz Tisdall, Lincolnwood Mayor, Jerry Turi, Evanston Alderman, Melissa Wynn. Okay, now we got judges. I love my judges. Okay, Helene Berger, Steve Bernstein. Where's my judges continued? Hold on. I got it. I'll find it. Jean Cleveland Bernstein, Eileen Burke, Allison Conlon, Jerry Esrig, William Gamboni, Alexandra Nikolich Gillespie, Deborah Gubin, Anjana Hansen, Rosemary Higgins, Nate House, he's got a table, Marilyn Johnson, James Kaplan, Bertina Lampkin, Anna Loftus, Mark Lopez, Pamela Loza, Maritza Martinez, Claire McWilliams, Martha Mills, retired, Leonard Murray, Michael Otto, Eve Riley, Jesse Reyes, Abby Fishman Romanek, Andy Schleifer, Naomi Schuster, Raul Vega, Deb Walker. If I miss somebody, you'll come and tell me. Okay, Democratic Party officials, Matt Flam, Palatine Committeeman, 10th District State Central Committeewoman, Lauren Beth Gash, New Chair Committeeman, Dean Maragos, 48th Ward Committeeman and 9th District State Central Committee, my dear friend Carol Ronan, 8th District State Central Committee, Nancy Shepherdson. I think we've got a few more. Don't leave me yet. More people I want to introduce. We have candidates. Raja Krishnamurtha, candidate for U.S. Congress, Illinois 8th District.
You forgot two. Karen Yarbrough and Ann.
Okay. We have Honorable Brad Schneider, candidate for Congress, and once again will be. I think I said him, but we'll do it again. Nancy wrote, Kim Stone, candidate for Highland Park City Council. Come on. Michael Brenner, Illinois State Organizer for Hillary for America, is here. Paul Vallis, who we wanted to be Lieutenant Governor here. Philippine Council General, Generosa Calonje, is here. Mona Noriega, Chairman and Commissioner of the City of Chicago's Commission on Human Relations. Amy Campbell, New Cook County Public Defender, is here. Karen Yarbrough, Cook County Recorder of Deeds, is here. And Evanston Alderman is here. And Bill Maravitz, 9th District Committeeman, is here. Okay. No, I didn't. Okay. I have a couple of other introductions I want to make. You know, we are so lucky to have Sister Simone Campbell, and I'll introduce her in a minute. But as a consequence, we have a number of outstanding leaders in the Catholic community. I wanted to make sure that we recognize Father Mike Garanzini, the president and CEO of Loyola University, who is here, retiring after 14 years. We also have Sister Pat Murphy and Sister Joanne Persh. They are Sisters of Mercy who go every week, rain or shine, to pray for the immigrant detainees outside the Federal Detention Center in Broadview. That's the last stop before deportation, and I want to extend an invitation on their behalf. You can join them every Friday at that detention center. I'm going to be going. I want to introduce Sister Pat Crowley. She was former executive director, Howard Area Community Center, and Deborah's Place, and one of those upstart nuns that we love. Sister Donna Quinn, leader of Catholics for Choice, is here. Some of my favorite priests, Father Bob Oldershaw, my local Evanston priest at St. Nicholas Church, Father Dan Coughlin, former chaplain of the U.S. House of Representatives and a great friend. We've never had such a gathering of Catholic women, religious, and priests, and we welcome all of you. Hope this won't be the last time you come. And finally, I want to say this. I'm sure each of you has lost someone dear over the last year. Three special people in my life passed away. Alice Tregay from the Rainbow Bush Coalition with Reverend Jackson from day one, who inspired me in her tireless work, get this, to personally register over the years over 10,000 voters. She was a dear friend and a role model. We will miss her. Her family, James Tregay, is here, and her daughter. We lost a powerful leader in Reverend Willie Barrow, who I worked with as a consumer advocate since 1970. She, too, was a leader at Operation Push and the Rainbow Push Coalition, an active hero until the very end. My dear friend Charles Benton was a person who understood early the democratizing power of public media. The Benton Foundation, headed now by his daughter Adrienne Furness, will continue to advocate for open access to communications networks. We send our best to his wife of many years, Marjorie Benton. So I want to remember all of them. Here comes my speech. First of all, I want to thank all of the host committee for making this such a wonderful event. I want to thank Sarah Gersten and Jackie, her assistant. And I want to just introduce my family who is here, the love of my life, my husband Bob Creamer, my children, Mary and Ian, my son-in-law, my grandchildren, and my sister, Debbie Danoff, are here, too. Thank you. And cousins, and hi, everybody. Okay. I was born and raised in Rogers Park in Chicago. My father, Irwin Danoff, Rogers Parkers. My father, Irwin Danoff, sold furniture, and my mother, Tilly, was a Chicago public school teacher and proud member of the Chicago Teachers Union for decades. When I was 7 years old, my parents and big sister Debbie and I moved to a cozy three-bedroom home right near Rogers School and a short bus ride away from Sullivan High School, my alma mater. We were far from rich, but I never remember my parents worrying about money. In retirement, they were able to travel, thanks in large part to my mother's teacher's pension, which also assured our dad's income after she died. Every Sunday, we would drive down Western Avenue to visit my grandparents in Humboldt Park. My favorite place was the barn. Yes, the barn, now the garage. That was the home of Teddy the horse. Every morning before dawn, Teddy would pull my grandfather's wagon to the central market to pick up the heavy bags of potatoes and other vegetables that my grandfather would sell up and down the alleys, schlepping those bags up and down the back stairs. All four of his children went to college. On Sundays, the grown-ups would be in the kitchen gossiping in Yiddish. My grandparents left Russia and its pogroms against the Jews early in the last century. They and their children, except for the last, born as an American citizen, made their way with the help of the Salvation Army to Chicago. A typical immigrant story, a typical Chicago story. My mom would have had more siblings had it not been for the visiting nurse who told my grateful grandmother about birth control. Other children did better financially and educationally than my grandparents, and this was not big news. This was expected by just about everyone. In our case, we had a cottage in Michigan City, built in part by my dad's hands and shared by my aunt and uncle. Even the men who worked a union job in the Southside steel mills in the 50s and 60s could actually afford a cabin where wife and the kids could go for the summer. Those are gone now, torn down for bigger homes for wealthier people. I graduated with a degree in elementary education from the University of Illinois, debt-free. We weren't rich. We weren't rich, but neither were we worried. Today, most families come home every night, as Rich Trumka, president of the AFL-CIO, said, to a full plate of worry. Many may describe my childhood as so 20th century, so yesterday, so gone and gone forever, so unrecognizable to the millennials in this room. But I want to tell a different story with a happy ending. That economic security for everyday Americans not only is possible, but unless we achieve it, all of us are in deep trouble, all of us. Okay, so now I'm gonna put my teaching degree to work. So pay attention, class. You don't need to take notes. I'll put it on the, I'll post a copy. Here's the most important data point to remember. The United States of America has never been richer. We're the richest country humanity has ever seen at its richest moment. When that fact is presented to focus groups, people don't believe it. Not surprisingly, because they themselves have been losing ground and have heard so many times that government is broke, that it can't be true, that our country is actually richer than ever. Now listen, since 1980, our economy grew a lot. Per person gross domestic product, that's the average wealth per person, grew 77%, and worker productivity by 75%. But 80% of workers got none of that gain from income growth. Zero. Zilch. So where did the money go? Well, you're a smart class, you know. It went to the top 20%, but mostly to the top 1%, and even more to the top 0.1%. It went to things like CEO salaries, which were about 20 times greater than their workers when I was a kid, now to almost 300 times greater, unless you're the CEO of Microsoft and you make over 2,000 times more than your typical worker. 8 Americans made at least $10 million each in 2013. $10 billion is as much as almost 200,000 Americans earn in a year combined. According to Larry Summers, our former Treasury Secretary, if the U.S. had the same income distribution it had in 1979, the bottom 80% of Americans would have $1 trillion more in income, and that's about $11,000 a family. I could go on, so I will for just a minute. Governor Bruce Rauner, who makes about $25,000 an hour, reduced his Illinois tax liability by $750,000 when the rate went from 5% to 3.5%. And now he wants to cut Medicaid by $1.4 billion and eliminate adult dental and foot care and breast and cervical cancer programs and take 30% from higher education and way more. And that's what you do with a turnaround company. Bottom line matters, and people don't. When I hear Republicans talk about shared sacrifice and making tough decisions and tightening our belts, as Rauner recently said, look out, because they are not talking about their belts. In Washington, The House and Senate Republican budgets cut funding for investments in health care, education, housing, and other domestic priorities by almost 40%, the lowest level in 50 years. They cut the SNAP program, that's the food stamp program, by $125 billion. So I stood on the floor of the House of Representatives and I looked right at my colleagues on the Republican side and I asked them, did you really come to Congress to take food out of the mouths of hungry children? Who are you? Thank you. They looked at me like, blah, 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 blah. Today, Americans can't afford to retire. 4 out of 5 households have less than 1 year's income in retirement savings. In fact, the average working household has only $2,500 in retirement assets. And for most seniors, their Social Security check is the bulk of their retirement. That's the majority, their retirement income. And for one quarter, it's the whole thing. Yet the average monthly check is this grand total of $1,300. And it won't surprise you, less for women. Our lower wages follow us into retirement. So in this richest country in the world, at its richest moment in history, government operates in a framework of scarcity when it comes to investments that help regular people. But the problem is that this is really bad, not just for the real people. It's bad for our entire economy. It's bad for all of us. Working families spend about 90% of their income on consumption, buying stuff. The rich spend less than 45%. In 2012 alone, an estimated $1.3 trillion was sucked out of our economy because it sat in the bank accounts of the richest Americans instead of actually being spent. And if that money went to people who would spend it, it's estimated that it would create 10 million jobs. Now, encroaching a bit on Sister Simone's turf, the Republican budget is not only bad for the economy, it happens to be immoral. Here's what Congressman Tom Price, he's the Republican chairman of the House Budget Committee, had the gall to say in justifying a budget that makes the worst income inequality since 1929 considerably worse. This is a quote from Tom Price. Many of our friends here on the floor have asked about budgets being moral documents, and they are. And let me ask, Madam Chair, where is the morality in trapping disadvantaged people in a web of welfare programs that discourage self-sufficiency and instead shackle them to government dependency? Where's the morality in heaping trillions of dollars of debt onto future generations to finance today's government spending because today's policymakers refuse to stop overspending? Tom, here's the sad truth. Nearly 80% of working families at some point, at least temporarily, will plunge into the red zone of poverty and need public benefits, according to Cornell sociologist Thomas Hirsch. Okay, I'm all done with the bad news. Now comes the good news part of my speech. There are solutions to all of these problems. We did not get to the solutions. Hear it for solutions. We did not get to this sorry place because of market forces or any forces beyond our control. Nobel laureate for economics Joseph Stiglitz said, inequality is not inevitable, inequality is a choice. It happened over decades. One tax break for rich people, one anti-labor provision, one loophole for oil companies, another for Wall Street, one anti-consumer regulation, drip, drip, drip. And the rich get richer, and middle class and poor get poorer. But we can unwind those laws, approve new regulations, invest in things that will help everyday Americans and rebuild the middle class. Last year, the House Democratic women, led by Nancy Pelosi, rolled out our economic agenda for women and families called When Women Lead, When Women Succeed, America Succeeds. And that's not just a slogan, it happens to be a fact. So try saying it with me. When women succeed, when women succeed, well, it feels good, doesn't it? Okay. The agenda includes equal pay for equal work, protecting and expanding Social Security, including giving work credits for caregivers, legislating paid family and sick leave, guaranteeing affordable quality child care and elder care and universal preschool, and today is the 50th anniversary of Head Start, by the way, supporting women entrepreneurs. Anniversary. Women entrepreneurs and small businesses, ending the crushing burden of college debt, which is now greater than all credit card debt combined. This is not a Mission Impossible agenda, and I, for one, am just full of really good ideas on how to do it. And I've actually introduced legislation that would accomplish things like the Fairness in Taxation Act, creating 5 more tax brackets, starting with millionaires up to a billion billionaires, the Stop Corporate Tax Dodging Act that Bernie Sanders and I have introduced. Yeah. And the Patriotic Employer Tax Credit Act that Dick Durbin and I are introducing this week, rewarding companies that hire Americans and treat them fairly. Now, so we know how to do bold reforms and shared sacrifice, and that makes a lot of sense to me. But here's the best news of all, and the reason that I keep smiling, even though it's pretty miserable in Washington these days, and people are always asking me, including this weekend at my neighborhood Jewel, how can you stand it? And my answer is that despite the way things appear right now, we are actually in a progressive, populist moment. Here's my evidence. More than 80% of Americans believe we should raise revenue for needed investments by closing corporate loopholes and limiting deductions for the wealthy. More than 60% of workers want to end the lower tax rate on income from capital gains and stock dividends so that actual work is not taxed as a higher rate than investments. 73% of Americans oppose cuts to Social Security. 81% of Americans say all workers should have a pension. I love that one. 2/3 of Illinois voters in 2014 supported referenda to raise the minimum wage. Thank you, Josina. She led that campaign. And add a 3% tax for millionaires in Illinois. Mike Madigan said he's going to call a vote on getting that to change the Constitution, I think. Anyway, call a vote before the end of the session. Now, these ideas aren't just sensible. They're popular. They are popular. We need to remember that. Much to the surprise of some of my colleagues, there really are very important things happening outside of the Capitol. There are nuns riding buses for faith, family, and fairness. All over the country, low-wage workers and tip-wage workers are fighting for $15 an hour and a union. You should join some of them like I have. It's exhilarating and effective. Being out in front of McDonald's or other fast food places with these courageous workers who are actually striking, even though they could be retaliated against. Minimum wages are being lifted all over the country thanks to their work. Bruce Rauner's obsessive fight against organized labor, I think, is actually helping to create a backlash. Good union jobs that afforded those Southside steelworkers of the 50s and 60s a decent middle-class life and a secure retirement do not have to be relics of the last century. Immigrants have inspired a new fighting spirit. A huge coalition, including most of the business community, supports comprehensive immigration reform. Today was the day that President Obama's executive orders to protect immigrants from deportation, DACA and DAPA, were supposed to go into effect, were it not for anti-immigrant lawsuits. But we will win this fight. Yes, we will. And when we do, it'll be a huge boon to our economy. Certain things have the stamp of inevitability about them, and immigration is at the top of that list, along with marriage equality. I am extremely optimistic about next year's elections. The super best news is that women hold the key to 2016. Okay. Feel your power. More than 50% of voters in the presidential election will be women, and more than 50% are very likely to vote Democratic, especially when given the opportunity at last to elect the first woman president in history. Are you ready for Hillary? Women, more specifically single women, are a powerful progressive voting bloc who favored Democratic candidates over Republicans by 60% to 38% in exit polls in 2014. And recent polls show they are looking for candidates who understand the day-in and day-out struggles for equal pay and health care and child and family care and education and tuition assistance, our women when women succeed agenda. They tell the pollsters that politicians who support their agenda will win their support, and in droves, they will come out in 2016. That's what they're saying. And you might have heard that the Republican war on women rages on. Last Thursday, with four exceptions, every Republican voted for banning abortions 20 weeks after fertilization, a ban enforced by criminal penalties. The bill has no health exception, and only an extremely narrow exception for when the woman's life is in danger. And you may also remember that a few months ago, Republican women actually rebelled against a very similar bill, this time with only one exception, a woman who voted present. All of the Republican women voted yes. We can and will still stop this legislation. But my sisters, have we had enough? Haven't we had enough? Last year, I talked about the 21st century being the century of the woman. But now let's take it in doable bites and focus on 2016 as the year of the woman. Elections really matter, as we are feeling painfully now with a Republican majority in Congress, both houses, and a Republican governor after an election when only one out of three eligible voters turned out. But with 539 days until the November 8th election next year, we must prepare ourselves for the celebration of a lifetime. We must prepare ourselves to make history. We can do it, and you'll be hearing from me and my new political director, Ben Head, about concrete things that each of us can do, challenging things, exciting things. It will be fun. We are smart enough, we are strong enough, and I'm looking at you, you're good looking enough, and I can feel it, that we are determined enough to make the change that we envision and that we want. So better days are ahead, and not a minute too soon for this amazing country of ours. Thank you. Right. Thank you. Okay. Thank you. Thank you. You can get it online. Okay. Thank you. Okay. Thank you. Okay. Now, so I'm about to introduce you to one of the most amazing and effective young leaders in our country, who exemplifies the incredible organizing that's happening that you will really be excited to hear about. Saru Jayamaran is, did I do that all right? Saru Jayaraman is the co-founder and co-director of the Restaurant Opportunities Center United, ROC United, an organization of more than 13,000 members, 100 plus employer partners, and several thousand consumer members in 32 cities nationwide. Her organization was founded after 9/11 with displaced World Trade Center workers for the purpose of building power and giving voice to restaurant workers in a way that has never existed before, fighting for good working conditions, benefits, and a living wage. And while we're at it, let's thank all the servers today who have done such a great job. I personally want to thank my constituent, Lazar, who is waiting on me today and pretty much every year. And thank you, Lazar. Okay. With over 10 million employees nationwide, the restaurant industry is one of the largest and fastest growing private sector employers in the nation. It is also the largest low wage industry in the country. Saru calls the National Restaurant Association the other NRA. But they have met more than their match in Saru, a graduate of Yale Law School and the Harvard Kennedy School of Government. She also serves as director of the Food Labor Research Center at the University of California, Berkeley. Join me in welcoming an amazing woman, Saru Jayamaran.
I cannot thank Jan enough for letting us be here, speak with you, and just for being the tireless fighter for workers and for women that she always has been. I heart Jan as well, in a big way. And besides the servers who served us today, I want to recognize the restaurant workers that have come who also heart Jan from all over the country. They're sitting in that table way in the back, and they've come from all over the country to be with you here today. So as Jan said, I fight, and the workers with me, we fight to change wages and working conditions in the restaurant industry, which is right now the second largest and absolute fastest growing sector of the U.S. economy. At this point, it's actually over 11 million workers. One in 12 Americans works in the U.S. restaurant industry, and yet it happens to be the nation's absolute lowest paying employer. Every year, the U.S. Department of Labor puts out a list of the 10 lowest paying jobs, and every year we win the award. 7 of the 10 lowest paying jobs every year are restaurant jobs, and the absolute 2 lowest paying jobs in the country are restaurant jobs. And all of the research shows that how is it that you've got the largest and fastest growing sector of the economy proliferating the absolute lowest paying jobs in the country? It's all due to the power and influence of a trade lobby that many of us haven't even heard of called the National Restaurant Association, which has been named the 10th most powerful lobbying group in Congress, is by far the most organized employer lobby in the world, and whose power dates back all the way actually to the emancipation of the slaves. So actually, tipping came to the United States from Europe in the 1850s, when rich Americans traveled to Europe and came back and wanted to show they knew the rules of Europe and tried to tip people in the States. Well, Americans resoundingly rejected the practice. There was a massive anti-tipping movement. Many states passed bans on tipping. But there were two industries in particular that squashed that movement, which, by the way, spread to Europe and succeeded in Europe, which is why there's no tipping in Europe. But here in the States, two industries squashed that movement, the restaurant industry and the Pullman Train Company, both of which wanted the right to hire newly freed slaves and not pay them anything and have them rely on customer tips. And if you know anything about labor history and racial justice history, you'll know that the Pullman car porters organized and won the right to an actual wage rather than relying on tips. But the restaurant workers were not so lucky. And that idea that the restaurant industry could get away
with not paying people anything and have them rely on our tips as their wages, was codified into the very first minimum wage law in 1938 under the New Deal, under FDR, which said, you have the right to the minimum wage either through wages or through tips, which meant the very first wage for tipped workers in the United States was zero. And we've gone from zero in 1938 to a whopping $2.13 an hour, which is the federal minimum wage for tipped workers in these United States in 2015, over a 100-year period. It is not much higher in Illinois. It is $4.95 an hour, nothing to laugh at. We have gone up $2 over 100 years, during which, that entire period, the other NRA has basically used the same argument. It's okay. We don't have to pay these workers. We shouldn't have to pay these workers. These are white guys working in fancy fine dining restaurants in downtown Chicago. There's no reason for us to pay them. They make $100,000 a year, when in fact, 70% of tipped workers in America are, guess who? Women. Women who work at IHOP and Applebee's and Olive Garden and Denny's. Women who suffer from three times the poverty rate of the rest of the U.S. workforce. Women who use food stamps at double the rate of the rest of the U.S. workforce, which means the women who put food on our tables in America can't actually afford to put food on their own families' tables. And here's the worst part. When you're a woman living off tips because you earn $4.95 in Illinois or $2.13 in New Mexico, you have to tolerate whatever a customer might do to you, however they may touch you or treat you or talk to you, because the customer is always right. And in fact, the research shows management encourages you to objectify yourself to get that money in tips. We had a member speak at a Senate press conference in Washington, D.C. She said, "Senators, what would it be like for you if your income depended on the happiness of the people you serve?" She said, I've only got 5 minutes. She said, because my income depends on the happiness of the people I serve, I have to put up with a guy groping my butt every day to feed my 4-year-old son at night. And that is the reality of 6 million women in America and 11 million restaurant workers every day. Because guess what? Unfortunately, we as the left, we as people who care about workers, we bought it. We bought it hook, line, and sinker. We have given in to the Restaurant Association. We have compromised. Every time the minimum wage has gone up, we've said, okay, it's all right. We'll leave the tipped workers out. It just happened in Illinois. It just happened here in Chicago. The wage went up to $13, except for guess who? Tipped workers, who were left at $5.95 an hour. It's not malicious. We just didn't know until recently who these workers were. We were throwing women under the bus every single time. There are 7 states, including nearby Minnesota, that have said to the restaurant industry for decades, no, you will have to pay the full minimum wage. You will have to pay these workers a wage plus tips. And that is what we need everywhere. So we said enough is enough. We've got a campaign called One Fair Wage. If California, Oregon, and Minnesota, and Alaska can do it, so can Illinois, so can every state in the country. One fair wage. And now we've got legislation moving in 5 states in the East Coast. We've got ballot measures moving in multiple cities and states along the East Coast. And thanks to Jan Schakowsky and Democratic leadership in the House and the Senate, we have a bill in Congress that for the first time in U.S. history proposes getting to $12 for all workers, tipped and non-tipped. That is historic. That is historic. And if it happens, it will mean overcoming a legacy of slavery. But she needs your help. We need Chicago and Illinois to also say, we stand behind tipped workers. We will not let this happen here in Chicago or Illinois also. Because guess what? There's one other reason why Chicago is so important. Guess where the NRA is headquartered? Right here. And across town at McCormick Place, they're having their annual trade show with 65,000 restaurant owners. They just had their big keynote address yesterday, and it was Don Sweeney, the head of the NRA, with Arianna Huffington talking about the American dream and talking about how they had won so many things. They had pushed back on minimum wage. They had tried to kill the ACA and healthcare reform. They had killed the labor organizing reforms. They were so proud, our American dream. And our workers courageously stood up and said, guess what? 213 is not our American dream. Stop it. And so we need your help as restaurant workers. We need everybody to stand with us. For the 6 million workers who put up with this every day of their lives, women. For the 11 million workers in this industry who live in poverty. But for every one of us who wants to say, a trade lobby should not dictate who works in this industry, how they work, and how a woman's body is treated in the workplace, we the people should. Thank you.
I told you. Yep, I told you. Saru Jayaraman. I told you. Okay, now it's such an honor for me. Oh, wait a minute. I wanted to introduce also, I forgot to introduce my judge friends, Patty O'Brien Sheehan and Rosanna Fernandez, Your Honor. Okay, thank you. I wanted to mention, I just found out the other day, the people who push the wheelchairs at the airport, they are tip wage workers. So think about that. If you didn't know that, if you are in need of that service, they rely on tips. Religious leader, attorney, poet, organizer, lobbyist, and friend to the voiceless, Sister Simone Campbell is one of the most extraordinary persons I know. Sister Simone has served as executive director of Network since 2004. In Washington, she lobbied on issues of peace building, immigration reform, healthcare, and economic justice. During the 2010 congressional debate on healthcare reform, she wrote the famous Nuns' Letter supporting the Affordable Care Act and got 59 leaders of Catholic sisters to sign on. The letter to members of the House, where the outcome was hanging in the balance, in large part because of the Catholic bishops had come out against it over a non-existent abortion issue, said, quote, we write to urge you to cast a life-affirming yes vote when the bill comes to the floor of the House for a vote as early as this week, unquote. This was a critical turning point in the last-minute struggle to pass the Affordable Care Act. This also marked the beginning of the attack of the Vatican on the nuns, singling out Network for special attention, accusing them of a host of sins, including, quote, a prevalence of certain radical feminist themes incompatible with the Catholic faith, unquote. That fight quietly ended a short time ago when it was dropped under Pope Francis. Undaunted, in 2012, Sister Simone organized the Nuns on the Bus tour of 9 states to oppose the Paul Ryan budget that would decimate programs meant to help people in need. They received an avalanche of attention, which led to a key primetime speech at the Democratic National Convention that fall. She had 3 cross-country Nuns on the Bus trips focused on economic justice, comprehensive immigration reform, where 2 of our sisters were on that bus. And voter turnout. I highly recommend that you buy her book, which is going to be sold in the back of the room, and read the great stories of her life and her work and her bus trip. A woman of deep faith, strong conviction, great courage, who sometimes jokes that she might be the stomach acid in the body of Christ. Sister Simone Campbell.
What a joy to be here. And what a fabulous view it is from up here to see women of power engaged in claiming a new way forward. What makes me so excited about this opportunity is the chance to talk together about how we deal with conflict to make something new. Jan, I loved what you said in your speech about the reality of economics in our time. That is the truth. But you know what? It is as Jan says, so many people don't believe it's possible to change it. Our choices as a nation made our economic reality what it is today. And you know what? Our choices can change it back to where we, the people, believe it needs to be. But what it takes, I've discovered, is a vision of an alternative way forward. I'm haunted by a man I met in Louisville, Kentucky on the bus. And we were in Louisville, Kentucky at Shively Area Ministries and having a lovely visit, very hospitable. And I was talking to this man, probably in his late 70s, who was there to get a little extra food. He and the wife had SSI, Medicaid, and they got food stamps, but they needed a little extra. So I was really taken with him, and we're chatting, and his wife has diabetes, and things were tough. And then we were on a voter turnout bus trip, so I asked him, are you gonna vote? And he says, yep, gonna vote, me and the wife, gonna vote. And then there was this pause, and he added, straight Republican. My temptation was to shake him. But that wouldn't be good as a Catholic sister getting in the headlines, nun shakes man. Instead, where I went was a place of curiosity because I didn't understand why. And so I said to him, well, why is that? Could you tell me? And he paused and he thought and he finally said, well, Mitch understands me. Mitch McConnell may understand him, but he votes against everything this man needs. But then I thought, here's one of the biggest challenges that we are facing as a nation, is that people are desperate to be identified with something bigger than themselves. And it is that hunger that causes people to try to latch on to anything, even if it's not in their own interests. The feeling is I would rather feel understood than considered when it comes to policy. I would rather be engaged with someone I can look up to than think, what do these policies have for me? People in the United States are not selfish. We are a generous-hearted people, and that generous heart even comes to who we identify with in politics. I think we the people, have a lot of work to do in building a community where people know they're not alone, where we can have the real conversations about tipped workers, where we can have the real conversations about this man at Shively Area Ministries, where we can stand together. And so as I was preparing for this talk, I wanted to recommend to women of power that we exercise holy curiosity and incessant gossip. holy curiosity will bring us to that moment when we're in a Denny's and we say to the waiter or waitress, are you just making minimum wage? Are you dependent on tips? Holy curiosity will bring us to a car wash, and car washes here in Chicago have a really problematic issue going on, because when we were here on the bus in September, we heard from a woman at Arise Chicago, which is a fabulous labor rights protection group, and we heard from her. She's an undocumented immigrant. She had worked for 13 years at this car wash through winters for tips only. Because the employer said, you know, labor laws don't apply to immigrants. After 13 years, someone finally put her in touch with Arise, and she was able to get some back pay, only 4 years worth because of a statute of limitations. But we, the people, we, the women of power, can use our curiosity to build community, to build this knowledge base, to build relationship so that we, the people, shape the future. It requires smart policy, but the first thing it requires is knowing the people who struggle, knowing the stories of real people. And the way I talk about it is that it's about touching the pain of the world as real, and if our hearts are broken open, then there's room for everyone. That's the challenge. That's what we have to do. That's what women are good at doing. We are great at welcoming in. That's part of our role. I don't know if it's nature or nurture, but hospitality, as evidenced by this fabulous meal, is definitely at the heart of our being. Holy curiosity requires us to go out to those who struggle. Let me give you one example. I met Robin, this wonderful young woman, at the, I love this. Sister Simone says, I met Robin at the White House when I was there waiting for the president. I mean, can you believe? Anyway, but Robin was there, and the president was going to sign the executive order to raise the minimum wage for federal contract workers. And Robin was so excited. She was probably like mid to late 20s, and she caught my attention. I was sitting next to her, but she stands up and takes a picture of the chair she was sitting in. And then she asked me if I would take a picture of her in her chair. And she was so excited. She had grown up in the area and had walked past the White House, and she had never thought she'd be there inside. And then she said to me, well, she was there because her friend was gonna get a raise because of the president's order. And she knew that if her friend got a raise, eventually she would, because she works in a national profitable clothing store chain but made $7.25 an hour. And she had worked there for more than a year. And after we talked a bit and I complimented her on her fabulous sapphire blue dress that she had gotten, she told me, with her employee discount on sale for $20.43, it was wonderful. Those of us who like bargains can appreciate that. But then she said to me, you know, by looking at me, you would never know that I have to live in a homeless shelter because I don't make enough to pay for rent in this DC area. It's wrong in the richest nation on earth that women work full time and have to live in a homeless shelter. It's wrong in the richest nation on earth that anyone working has to live in a homeless shelter. It's wrong that people have to live in homeless shelters. It is wrong. But here's where the Republicans get it right. They get it right that the safety net should not be a permanent condition. They get that right. The safety net is planned for those folks who are falling through the cracks. But do you know what's happened? Jason, an entrepreneur, pointed this out to me. He said that he was getting upset because he paid all his people a living wage. But what was happening was he realized his taxes were going to fund his competitors. And I go, what? Your taxes are funding your competitors? I don't understand. And he went on to explain that his competitors pay minimum wage to many of their low-skilled employees. And because they pay minimum wage to their low-skilled employees, they have those employees go use the safety net, like Robin, so that she can survive. And Jason realized while he paid a living wage, his competitors could bid lower on contracts because they had lower employment costs. So Jason realized his taxes were funding his competitors to pay low wages. That is the structural problem we have in the United States, where work does not pay. And the expectation is that employees use what was supposed to be an emergency safety net. The only reason Republicans could be right that the safety net program has become a hammock is because businesses are taking advantage of hard-working, desperate people who work for wages that are below what they need to survive. We, the people, have got to stand up and say, in the richest nation on earth, we are better than this. We are better than this. And Jan mentioned that the average salary for a CEO of a publicly traded company is $10 million a year. That was a year ago. And that they were going for $11 million. Well, I got this chance in a business roundtable that we're hosting this year to ask the question, well, is it that you're not getting by on $10 million? Do you need a little extra? And do you know what the answer was? Like this, one of the entrepreneurs said, oh no, Sister Simone, it's not about the money. It's not? It could have fooled me. He says, no. We're very competitive, and it's about winning. Money just happens to be the measure of winning. Well, my very curious and gossipy women friends in this room, we have got to change the measure of winning to something a little less toxic. It is wrong in the richest nation on earth when a CEO makes in 3 hours what Robin makes in a full year. Do you know, though, the CEO is dependent on Robin? The CEO would have nothing if he or she did not, and mostly he's, I might say, nothing about a glass ceiling that we ought to ignore, but that the CEO is as dependent on Robin as Robin is on the CEO. The CEO is dependent upon the janitors that are often outsourced or separately contracted and receive minimal pay. The CEO is really dependent on all the workers to have that profit. Wow. And when I said that in one small group, one person said to me, ah, yes, but Sister Simone, the CEO never sees those people. He thinks it's just the elves come in and take care of it. So what we gossipy, curious women have got to do is begin to gossip with CEOs about the reality of who makes their wealth, of who makes their business successful, of who makes it possible. We've got to take our courage in our hand and tell the stories of people who won't be heard in places we can go. That is what we're called to. So what I know is also is that it's not just about the CEO, it's not just about Robin, it's not just about this measure of winning. Do you know what? It's about all of us. All of us, the 100%, have a responsibility to pay a just price, not the cheapest price. That means that we are in this together. The 100% maintain this status quo, just as the way we heard that our tipping perpetuates the NRA. We've got to change that. We've got to talk about it. Not so our people suffer, but so that policies can change. But you know what I've discovered? If you let your heart be broken open by just one story, and you begin to gossip and talk about it, things change way more than what we can ever imagine. Things change in ways that are way beyond us. Some of you have heard me tell the story of Margaret, who died in Cincinnati in 2012 when we were on the bus. And her sister Jeannie brought me Margaret's picture to our gathering in Cincinnati. And so I've talked about Margaret. Margaret died because when she lost her job in the recession, she lost her health care. And when she lost her health care, she lost her capacity to get screened for colon cancer. Margaret would have been eligible for Medicaid if the Affordable Care Act had been fully implemented and Medicaid fully expanded. I have become a passionate nut, a curious gossiper about Medicaid expansion in every conceivable corner of our nation. Now, some in my beloved church hold birth as being the key issue that they work on. But I have to tell you, our story is much bigger than that. It's about all of life. And for me, it is a pro-life stance to say Margaret had a right to health care. But let me tell you a surprise. So I've been passionately talking about Margaret, and Margaret fuels my passion for policy change. Last fall, after we were in Louisville, we went to Lexington and had a big rally. And I was there trying to get my head together before the rally, and this woman comes up, taps me on the shoulder, and says, "I'm Nancy, I'm one of Margaret's sisters. I just want to thank you for healing my family." What? You know how that is when you're thinking about one thing and somebody interrupts, and it's like, what did I hear? So I ran after her, grabbed her, said, what? Well, it turns out that Margaret's family, her five siblings, had been fighting with each other, saying, "Well, you should have taken care of her." They didn't know how sick she was. "Well, you're the nurse. You should have looked in on her. Or you're the rich one. You should have gotten her some health insurance." They felt so guilty. They were blaming her, blaming each other. But Nancy told me my speaking about Margaret meant that their family began to see some sense in an otherwise senseless death. It gave meaning to their pain and healing to their family, and taught me that when we each let our hearts be broken open by one story, when we talk and gossip about that story, I think in other settings I might call it missionary work, but we'll just call it gossiping among us girls, okay? But when you do that, you never know where the healing happens. So trust that we are in this together, and if we let our hearts be broken and we act on just one thing, we can make a difference. We may not know what that difference is, but it's us standing together, making community, makes it happen. We have a huge challenge ahead of us in the next 500 and however many days that was. I can hardly even bear the thought. But knowing the stories of Robin and Jason and Margaret and Nancy impel me to make a difference in just one little place, to work for a vision where all are welcome, to work for a vision where we all can work with dignity and to care for their families, where work pays and we pay just wages and just prices, and CEOs find another way to feel successful and know that they've got to share with their employees. This is the America we can create if we hold out the vision. Now, many people tell me they feel a little overwhelmed when I get through talking because it just seems impossible. But Pope Francis, who I just think is fabulous, says that, I know, it's kind of cool. He says in his exhortation, Joy of the Gospel, he says that Jesus says in our Christian scriptures, when the apostles are saying, oh, help, 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 Jesus says to about the hungry crowds, feed them yourselves. Well, now I feel a little overwhelmed with that, and I want to close with a poem I wrote about it because I think it's what we have to do. Many of you know the Christian story of loaves and fish, and if you don't know it, I'll give you the summary. A bunch of people like this, about this size, were following Jesus to listen to him talk, only they didn't have lunch provided. And so they're out in the desert, and the apostles start getting nervous that they're going to get grumpy and hungry. And so the apostles say to Jesus, send them back to town to get food. And then Jesus says, feed them yourselves. Well, the apostles say, well, what we got? I mean, five loaves and a couple of stinky fish. That's all we've got. And then Jesus, the community organizer, had people sit down in groups of 50, and he allegedly blesses it, and things happen. All are fed. And then at the end of Matthew's Gospels, one of the Christian scriptures, it says, 5,000 men were fed, to say nothing of the women and children. Now, I thought you, my sisters, might appreciate that made me a little upset. So I prayed about it. What could that possibly mean? Jesus always respected the women. Not necessarily like some other folks I know, But what I finally figured out was they only counted the ones who thought it was a miracle. The women had brought snacks from home. What woman is going to go out for the day with the family All right, now you got it. But our challenge, when we hear these words, feed them yourselves, is sometimes we can feel overwhelmed ourselves. I urge you, oh progressive women of power, don't tie yourself in a knot feeling you have to do everything. Let your heart be broken by one story and act on it. Do one thing. And as long as you do your thing in community, it'll all get covered. It'll all be responded to. That's the message of being community. So when you're feeling a little overwhelmed and you feel like somebody is saying to you when you've raised a problem, you call Jan Schakowsky's office and they to fix a problem and they say, "We'll take care of it yourself." Here's a poem for that moment. I always joked that the miracle of loaves and fish was sharing. The women always knew this. But in this moment of need and notoriety, I ache, tremble, almost weep at folks so hungry, malnourished, faced with spiritual famine of epic proportions. My heart aches with their need. Apostle-like, I whine. What are we among so many? The consistent 2,000-year-old ever-new response is this. Blessed and broken, you are enough. I savor the blessed, cower at the broken, and pray to be enough. Thank you very much.
Beautiful. Thank you, Sister Simone. Thank all of you so very much. I hope you feel inspired to do something, to feel yourself, to be enough. I want to say two things. One, if you call my office, we will not tell you to take care of it yourself. We will help you. And two, the people who served you are part of Local One, hotel and restaurant workers, and they actually do make a real salary. So thank you very much for coming. Let's change the world together.